Blackstone Audio presents The Diviner's Tale by Bradford Morrow. If a man could pass through paradise in a dream and have a flower presented to him as a pledge that his soul had really been there, and found that flower in his hand when he awoke, aye, and what then? Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Everyday life is only an illusion behind which lies the reality of dreams. Werner Herzog. Part 1. Divining Cassandra. Chapter 1. My father, whom I trust as surely as yesterday happened and tomorrow might not, was the first to call me a witch. He meant it in a loving way, but he meant it. In later years, he'd sometimes say it with a defiant touch of pride. My daughter, the witch. I brought this on myself by warning my brother Christopher with all the raw certainty of a 7-year-old who believed she could see things hidden from others, not to go to the movies one August evening with his best friend, Ben. He laughed, like any older brother twice his sister's age would, and said I could take a metaphysical flying leap. I can still picture him, lanky, loose-jointed, tall as a tree to my eyes, wearing his favorite faded baseball jersey untucked over a pair of worn jeans and scuffed brown boots. Hey, nutcracker, see you in the afterlife. Turning, he clomped down the porch stairs 2 steps at a time to the waiting car. I remember lying in long orchard grass in the field beyond our house, listening to the restless crickets scraping their bony legs together and waiting for the meteors to tell me when the worst had come to pass. At first, the sky was calm, just an infinity of cold stars and a few winking planets out in the void, carving their paths through the darkness. Maybe I got it wrong, I hoped. But then so many shooting stars started chasing across the night, I couldn't begin to know which of them had carried my beloved laughing brother away. The crickets stopped their chorus as the whole field sank into silence. I sat up and gasped. How I wished what I saw above me was a great black slate instead of a brilliant light show. Defeated by my vindication, I walked back to the house and sneaked in the side door. "That you, Cass?" my mother called out. My mother, who could hear a mouse yawn the next county over. No, I whispered, not wanting to be me anymore. Christopher never came back. Neither did Ben, or Ben's father, Rich Gilchrist, who was the town supervisor. The funeral was attended by 500,000 people. That happens when you are a well-liked local politician and chief of the volunteer fire department. Not to mention a decorated war veteran. Many men in dress uniforms attended from all over Corinth County in rural upstate New York and across the Delaware into Pennsylvania. Phalanxes of fire trucks, bright as polished mirrors, lined the road beside the churchyard cemetery. People wept in the wake of all the eulogies, and afterward, the bells tolled. It was the second big funeral in as many years. Emily Schaefer, Chris's classmate, was killed the year before in what some believed was not the accidental death the authorities declared it. And our town still hadn't recovered. Whereas before we followed one hearse to the cemetery, this year 3 coffins were carried out together after a joint service, one draped with an American flag and 2 smaller unadorned ones behind. To this day I can hear the bagpipes playing their dirge. Family friends and Christopher's inseparable band of buddies, Bib, Jimmy, Lair, Charlie Granger, my favorite, even the brooding Roy Scholar, who slipped out back to smoke, came over to our rambling farmhouse afterward, and everyone ate from a smorgasbord and drank mulled cider and spoke in low, shocked voices. As for myself, I hid upstairs. I felt guilty, bereft, also angry. If he hadn't so simply ignored me
things might have turned out different. I barricaded my door that night and spent hours memorizing my brother's narrow, freckled face, his edgy voice, his gawky mannerisms, his lame jokes, the Christopher-ness of him, so I could hold him as long as possible in the decaying cradle of memory. Instead of sleeping in my bed that night, I lay fitful on the floor, twisting around in my funeral clothes, hugging my doll Millicent, who was my first confidant and imaginary little sister. Why?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.